Welcome to Sunnyvaleans, a show all about Sunnyvale, California. Today, we're going to be looking at the housing crisis. Everybody knows that the housing crisis is driving everybody nuts. Prices are sky high, but we can't seem to agree on what to do about it. Here to talk about these issues is Sunnyvale's Vice Mayor, Gustav Larsson. Welcome, Gustav. Thanks for being here.
Thank you very much.
Well, you have become the go-to guy in Sunnyvale for the housing issue. You're a big proponent of affordable housing tours, and this is since your days on the Planning Commission. While chair of the commission, you shepherded the Onizuka Crossing Homeless Housing Project, and you are a regular on the housing panels, and you go to a lot of these discussions, like the one at the Onizuka Crossing itself and at the Democratic Club of Sunnyvale. You even represented Sunnyvale at the Julian Castro-led Housing and Urban Development Regional Leadership Roundtable on Housing, Affordability, and Economic Mobility. You support housing consistently, especially affordable housing, on City Council, and you just pushed for the highest housing alternative on the El Camino Real corridor in the last City Council meeting. What can you tell us about the current housing situation here in Sunnyvale?
Well, first of all, thank you for that very kind introduction. I do have to tip my hat to Councilmember Jim Griffith.
Right.
He has been an advocate for housing for longer than I have been involved with either the Planning Commission or City Council. So, and even before him, Sunnyvale has actually been, for many, many years, been very active in developing affordable housing. So I feel like I'm a fairly new player on the team. Mm-hmm. It's a team effort. We've worked on it for many years. And today's housing situation has actually developed over many, many years.
Yeah, yeah. I understand that there's an advocacy group that has been around since like the 1960s. And
yes.
It hasn't seemed to stop being an issue. And it seems like it's worse now. When I look on Craigslist, I see ads $4,000 to $5,000 a month for an Eichler in Sunnyvale. Those things sold for $20,000 when they were built in the 60s. And then the Onizuka Crossing project that we mentioned, there are 58 units, but there's 1,823 applicants on the waiting list. And this is a pretty big indication that we have some serious problems. But unfortunately, there really isn't any more room to build. The only sizable piece of land that's never been developed is the former Corn Palace. And that is 10 acres. And this is, of course, the two brothers who used to own the Corn Palace. One of them passed away several years before, and his heirs immediately sold the land and developed it. What was that, 50, 52 units?
That's right, yes, around 50 single-family homes.
Single-family homes, that's right. But I don't know what's going on with the remaining 10 acres. The other brother did pass away, but his heir hasn't seemed to really done anything with it. What can we do? How did we get here? And what can we do to kind of solve the problem?
Yeah, well, so this area is a very popular area. I think we all know how well the tech economy is doing here.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, Silicon Valley is known all over the world. And so the innovation that we do here is contributing to the world economy. We have people coming from everywhere, companies that want to be part of this area who are hiring here.
Mm-hmm.
So that's good economically, but it creates a lot of demand for where are people gonna live when they come here.
Yeah.
And so that's been a challenge for many years. And when I look back at the data over at least the last 15 or 20 years,
mm-hmm.
A lot of our population growth is actually happening in existing housing because we're not building enough housing for the people coming here. So one of the things that we see today are people starting to double and triple up in housing. I hear more and more anecdotes of multiple families sharing the same house. I mean, the phrase single family home is almost becoming a misnomer because sometimes it's multiple families or multi-generational families. Mm-hmm. And just recently, St. Cyprian Church in Sunnyvale did a survey of some of their parishioners, and they found that for those parishioners who lived in apartments, they had an average of almost three people per bedroom in those apartments. Not three people per apartment, three people per bedroom. And I think that's another side of the housing crisis that is not apparent to everyone. That, you know, we can look in the papers and we can see what the for sale prices are, how high they've gotten, or we hear about the rents, but we don't always hear about the overcrowding that's happening more and more.
That's right, that's right. And it's not just low-income families.
Yes.
It's also reaching the middle classes or even the upper middle classes, because we know that kids come back after going to college because they can't afford to live anywhere else.
Yeah.
And we're going to have, we might have to go back to multi-generational families living in the same home just because the youngsters can't find a place to live, and the empty nesters who want the empty nest are not really going to have that opportunity to turn that son's bedroom into a den or like a Pinterest studio or something like that. So with the current economy being the way it is, there's really no way to put the brakes on people coming here. And I kind of don't think that we want to do that, because this is the land of opportunity. We can't really be fair and say, oh, only the people who've already been here should be able to enjoy the quality of life here, because like you said, the affordability factor in Sunnyvale has been going on for a really, really long time. And I have to say, I've been a recipient of that myself, because when my family first moved to California and into Sunnyvale, we did go into one of the affordable apartments on Helen Avenue. And this was, you know, way back in the day. I don't want to say how far back in the day, but it was a while ago. And I want to be able to say that people coming in now could have the same opportunities that I had when my family first came here. What can we do? What can the city do to facilitate that?
Well, I think you're absolutely right that opportunity is a big part of this. And it's actually, I think, part of the American dream, the American story.
Yeah.
To be able to find the opportunity and to benefit from that. Mm-hmm. It also gets to the question of who is able to live in Sunnyvale? Mm-hmm. Who is able to live here? What is the mix of people? You had mentioned parents whose kids have grown up but can't move out of the house. And we've actually had people come down to council and say, I'm here to support housing because I want my daughter to have her own place and I don't want her to have to live, you know, under the same roof with us anymore. You know, I want her nearby. It's great to have the kids nearby, but, you know, we want to each have our own space.
Yeah.
So there are a number of things that the city has done. It's almost like we need an all of the above strategy. There's no one single thing that's going to address the housing need. And there are so many different needs that we have as well. Mm. More specifically on the affordable housing, Sunnyvale has recently raised its developer fees. So we're collecting fees on housing developments and actually on commercial developments as well. Mm-hmm. And then we can channel that money to the nonprofit developers of affordable housing. They get to leverage that money. There's some other federal and state money that they can use. And then they can build affordable units, or they can rehab existing apartments and keep those affordable. So that's a very important program that we have. We're also starting to look more at smaller units. And this would be for market rate units, but if they're smaller, it's going to be less expensive to rent them. So they're naturally affordable to people. So natural affordability is another piece of this. We do have a requirement already that for sale housing, that one out of eight, every eight units is made available to folks at a deep discount for people who are actually making median income. I think it says a lot when people who are making median income here still need a deep discount to be able to afford to buy a place.
Yeah.
And then on the rental side, we also have other programs. For reasons of state law that I'm not going to get into right now, we can't have exactly the same program where we can't require the units, but we can collect the fees and then go somewhere else and build affordable housing units with them.
Okay. Well, let's talk about some of the specific developments in the pipeline. How many units are coming up for development in the next, say, 2 or 3 years?
So I'm not sure that I can tell you exactly what's going to happen in the next 2 or 3 years. When we talk about the pipeline, that usually includes projects that are under construction now that will be finished soon, projects that are approved but haven't started construction, but also things that have just been proposed. They're a twinkle in someone's eye, but they haven't gone through the approval process yet, and they may not get approved. So we don't know how much of it'll get built, but we have between 4,000 and 5,000 housing units mm-hmm. in the pipeline right now. So in the foreseeable future, a substantial amount of housing we expect to be coming online.
Okay, that sounds reasonable. Will it meet the demand?
I think there's even more demand. Because for so many years we have not been meeting the demand, we've dug ourselves into a deep hole, and it's going to take a while mm-hmm. To dig ourselves out of it. That said, it's important to keep working on it. We can't give up just because we can't solve it in 2 years. But we're certainly, as a city council, we're looking around all around the city mm-hmm. for opportunities where it really makes the most sense to add more housing. So on El Camino, for example, you had mentioned that the city council was looking at that at the last council meeting. Not a final decision. There's still more work to be done. Mm-hmm. But we were looking at places along El Camino that don't back up directly to single family homes.
Okay.
But maybe are closer to the really very popular bus stops, where the 522 bus stops, for example. There's a lot of commercial land around there. Maybe we can put housing above the retail, above the shopping there. And I think that would actually help those businesses. And it would allow people to live close to a transit line. So if your job or your shopping is along El Camino, that's very convenient. And it's a lot better to build up in those areas instead of out into the neighborhoods. We absolutely want to protect the existing neighborhoods that we have, because we really value the character of those neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we want to have opportunities for other people who are coming here to maybe they've just graduated, they're starting out, they can't afford a single family home yet, but they can, or they're in a transient part of their life. So we want to make sure that there are places for them as well.
Okay. Yeah, there have been some instances of the community being fairly blindsided when a new development came online a little too fast. And I think a lot of their concerns are very justified. It just seems very sudden. First of all, nobody really likes development. They like Sunnyvale the way it is. It's a quiet, safe hometown feel, and we want to keep it that way. People are remembering a time when there were like 10,000 people in the city, but we've kind of gone beyond that. We're like 140,
150,000,
160, and it seems to be trending upwards. there's really no easy way to deal with that. But the people who've been here for a really, really long time, they really don't want to see Sunnyvale turn into a giant city. And it kind of feels like we're in some danger of that happening. What do you see in terms of people's attitudes? Like, for instance, when you come across them just in everyday life or at public events or even at city council meetings, what have you noticed about the tone of or the temperature of the city in terms of how much development they want to see and how fast?
I'm hearing several different things. So I'm definitely hearing people expressing their concern. That certainly as they see taller buildings, and especially because the taller buildings tend to be congregated right along the busy corridors, that makes them very visible.
Yeah.
Yes, that is a change to our community and something we need to be very thoughtful of. I think council has taken to heart the feedback from the community of wanting to hear more, wanting to participate more in the process.
Yeah.
And so we're definitely looking at ways, including trying to figure out social media, ways to push out more information and to get people more engaged, to get more information back as well, because that's really, really important. And I'm sorry, I've forgotten the rest of your question.
It generally answers how people are feeling now.
So the other thing I will say is I have certainly heard any number of people come up to me and say, let's consider this. And at the same time, I'd say within the last year or two, there's been more community support from people who are saying, look, you know, my kids can't afford to live here. I can't get a gardener because a gardener can't afford to live here.
Yeah.
I think we've all seen the help wanted signs at restaurants. Restaurants are having a hard time hiring people. So there has been a shift in the community conversation. There's not one voice from the community, but I think there's a growing understanding and appreciation of what happens if we don't have enough housing.
Yeah, that's not something that we really had to worry about in Sunnyvale, because we've never seen it quite like this. I was shocked when I read that, this was many years ago, a real estate broker was telling me, oh, you know, they sold the first $1 million house in Birdland. And I thought, Birdland? But $1 million? And now I look back on that day and said, only $1 million? Who could ever find $1 million house in Birdland at this point? And granted, Birdland is a very desirable neighborhood.
Yes.
They're a little under pressure right now from the development.
I totally understand that. Yeah. Yes, with the Apple II campus coming online.
Yeah.
And also in Santa Clara, there's some projects in Santa Clara near there. Yeah.
Yeah.
I get that.
Yeah, they're getting it from all sides, unfortunately. But hopefully it'll settle down. And I kind of suspect that the housing prices are just going to keep going up, because the people who are working at Apple will find it convenient to just walk across the street, walk across Homestead and get to work. Well, knock on wood, it all works out. But I've kind of noticed that the arguments for new housing is getting more of a reception. It's like getting a friendlier reception in Sunnyvale, which a few years ago I didn't think was the case. I think a lot of the arguments that people are making now make sense even to people who don't particularly want development. A lot of people in Sunnyvale are very green. They like sustainability. There's a sustainability commission.
Yes.
And it's a popular one. So there's a lot of argument to be made that if we build higher density in the right parts of town, near the transit corridors, not near the single family homes where the roads are too narrow to bear the traffic, and then places that have better better access to the major roads and better access to public transportation like the train or the bus, it makes more sense to have higher density housing because it's way more green. Can you tell me about some of the advantages of the newer, more sustainable buildings going up?
Yeah, so Sunnyvale has been a leader in developing a green building program. Mm-hmm. So when new buildings are constructed, they have to be more energy efficient, be more water efficient. Oftentimes, even though there may be more people in the building, they actually use less water and less energy than the building that was there before.
How does that happen?
Just by newer technologies and newer building techniques, mm-hmm. Are much better at keeping the energy in, using less water. The landscaping that's required is low water landscaping. So, you know, that's part of it. But then another part is when people can live closer to their jobs and live closer to where they shop, they don't need to drive as much. That's less pollution, less greenhouse gases that are produced. Just last week, I was talking with a small business owner in Sunnyvale, and a lot of his workers, this is a restaurant, his workers are now living in Gilroy and Santa Cruz and the Central Valley and commuting into Sunnyvale because they can't find a place to live here. Well, if they're commuting that far, they're driving on the highways. That makes the highways more congested. Highway miles are very expensive to develop and maintain. That's money that then can't be spent on local public transit. So the problem kind of reinforces itself when people can't live here. It also gets to how housing is really a regional issue. This is not just a Sunnyvale issue. It's not just a Silicon Valley issue. It's becoming a California issue. And so if people are not able to live here in Sunnyvale where they're working, then that puts pressure on the Central Valley on farmland to be converted, or wild areas, or down by Gilroy. We may not be redeveloping wilderness just yet, but it pushes people farther out, and that's just not good for the environment overall.
No, and in Sunnyvale in particular, they definitely do not want to see any green space get turned into buildings because they're very specific.
Yes, and I'd like to, something else I forgot to mention earlier, in addition to raising the developer fees, we're also collecting park money from developers.
Okay.
And so we're using that to either buy land or sometimes we require them to give us parkland because it can be difficult for us to go out and compete on the open market. So right now there are at least four or five new parks in the works in Sunnyvale through these programs.
Okay.
So we're actively looking to expand our parkland.
Yeah, I like the idea that we do a little more horse trading rather than trying to like compete on the open market, because I don't know that a municipality is going to be able to compete with, let's say, a luxury condo developer, and I would rather see like small parcels of land, like miscellaneous bits and pieces, get sort of redistributed in more sort of open market solutions rather than just being tied a little to, oh no, we can't sell any land under any circumstances, because that's not really the most efficient way to run, to deal with the resources that the city has.
Yeah, it's how can we best use the city's assets and resources to really serve the community?
Yeah.
We're always looking at that, yeah.
Okay, well, I'm glad you're, I'm glad you're thinking along those lines and being efficient and using the resources we have in the most responsible way possible.
Just a minute ago, you were mentioning the negotiation that goes on as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so in several areas in the city, we are focusing more heavily on community benefits.
Okay.
So parks are one community benefit, but sometimes we look at getting money for traffic improvements,
mm-hmm.
Or for a branch library, creating bike and pedestrian connections.
Okay.
So we can use these development projects to actually better the city for everyone.
Okay. Can you give us an example of like what's a really nice, snazzy benefit that we got from a major developer?
Well, I can think of several. And I think you're probably asking about housing in particular, because we also get these from office developments.
Mm-hmm.
So a small one that opened up recently is a housing and medical office along El Camino. It's right across from Lozano's car wash. And we negotiated for a bike and pedestrian cut through. So the neighborhood that's behind there, they no longer have to go all the way around the block to get to El Camino. They can actually just walk through into the Cala Shopping Center or bicycle. It's beautifully landscaped. It's lit at night, so it's safe. Really nice upgrade that we were able to do.
That's great. I'm really glad that we're having these great solutions to a lot of the problems that just seem too big and difficult and kind of amorphous, and you just can't seem to get a handle on it and things like that. But I'm glad to hear that the city is being very proactive about all the all the housing, the traffic, and stuff like that. So it's really nice to hear. Thank you so much for being here today. We could talk another 30 minutes to an hour easily about all the things that we could have covered but didn't. Plenty to talk about. So we'll have to have you on in a future episode to talk more about specific projects coming up. And if anything develops, you'll have to let us know.
Wonderful. I look forward to it.
All right. Great. Well, in the meanwhile, we are going to go out with a little bit of a feel-good story. With all the development going on, we don't always get to save the old houses, but we have one example of a local developer who decided to save a very, very nice period house from 1906. It's the Mellows Nursery, the old site on Matilda. The developers have decided, we're not going to tear down this cute little gingerbread house, we're going to save it, and we're going to turn it into like a conference center for the research and development site that they're going to do. And they're also going to save some of the nice old houses, like the old oak trees and things like that. So I will leave you with some footage of that, and I will also leave you with some images of Sunnyvaleans having a story in the local newspaper, the Sunnyvale Sun. So please to enjoy the beautiful images of Mellow's Nursery. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.